Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Elevate Your Equity podcast, where investors with a special emphasis on couples begin, continue, and deepen their journey to financial freedom together using the powerful vehicle of real estate investing to do it. Today on the show, we have a power couple, Jim and Linda Biggs. Jim is currently a founding partner at Jeroma Enterprises, where his valuable skills in business management, sales, marketing, finance, deal structure, and community development are being utilized to apply into his lifelong interest in real estate investing to enhance the value for his investors and his personal investments in multifamily commercial real estate. Jim comes from the background of steel manufacturing from 2018. He was in the maintenance division as a planner slash MTM, where he tendered relationships with vendors, tradesmen, and professionals in engineering, mechanical, electrical, machining, fabrication, manufacturing, and other various professional services. But today, his newest adventure is called the GOB Network of Apartment Investors. It's an open source, democratized, all-inclusive platform for apartment investors to be able to source deals, partners, and capital. And the platform also provides coaching, mentoring, teaching, and access to partnerships as GPs, key partners, limited partners, JVs, and other creative deal structures. He's created a lot of value in this platform called GOB. And in our conversation, we really touch on the abundance mentality and how important it is to just give and be a go-giver and then trust that that value will come back. And there's tons of other stuff in there too, right?
Absolutely. And including the four C's, they talk about the four C's as being the pillar to their business endeavors, their entrepreneurship, and as well as their marriage. So in order to listen for what those four C's are, tune in, listen to the very end.
And I would also say as well, in addition to the four C's, that Jim has been able to take those four C's with his wife and use it to massive success, because nowadays he's involved in syndications. He's got a couple of limited partner deals going on, and he's a general partner on at least four deals, I believe, going on right now. And this is relatively new to him, all from the GOB network. And so this is a fantastic show for you guys to listen in on. And with that said, I'm going to go ahead and stop talking and just bring him on. So let's go ahead and do that. Jim and Linda Biggs, thank you guys so much for being on the call. How are you today?
We are peachy keen, Gary. Right? We're very, very happy to be here.
We're so excited to have you on the podcast. We've been hearing so much about you, Linda, specifically, and Jim. You have a very big name in the circles that we run in, so we're very excited to be able to sit down with the both of you today. It's quite an honor. So why don't you guys tell us a little bit about what you guys are up to now, and then could you maybe back up and tell us how you guys got started in this whole investing game that we're in?
So 2021, for me, is really all about trying to build the GOB network. We're really focused almost exclusively on doing that. And that came about because we had in 2020, the worst year of our life in the first half of the year, and then the very best year of our life in the second half of the year. So there have been some good things that have come out of 2020. And we have been at this for most of my adult life, but it's been on again, off again. So I've been an entrepreneur for most of my life, but not necessarily in the real estate business. But every time I would have a venture come to a close, we'd always come back. And we retired about 3 years ago so that we could focus entirely on this endeavor.
Thank you so much for that. That's great. I read in your bio that you were in the engineering industry for a while and working a full-time job. And I'm just wondering, how did what you're doing today relate with that? Did you bounce back and forth, or was there conversations at home that kind of helped steer the direction there? Can you give us just a little bit of background on that situation?
I have not had too many W-2 jobs in my lifetime. I've never been the type of person that wanted to work, quote unquote, for the man. But I also always had this idea that coming from a very, very poor background, that I wanted to leave a legacy. I wanted to leave something for my family. And that was always intended to be a business. In my mind, you know, I'm starting a business. I'm going to build this business. That will be our retirement. And I'll pass it on to my kids. But unfortunately, that didn't work out so well 6 different times. And so there was a point where, when I was in my mid-40s, I would guess that we had had a correction, a misstep, if you will, and had picked another bad partner. And Linda asked me a very poignant question, which is, what happens to us when we retire if this doesn't work out? And to be honest with you, you know, when you're a father and a husband, that hits really, really, really close to home. And so I decided at that point that I had to do something that would bring some kind of security to our life. And so I went into what I lovingly call the family business, because Linda's family has worked in the steel industry for a long, long time. And we used to have family dinners Friday nights and Sunday afternoon, mid-morning breakfasts. And everyone would sit around the table and talk about the steel mills. But they would talk about the people that had died there that year, or the people that had been crushed, or the people that had worked all day long in a grease pit with the only light being the one on their helmet, and come out of it, you know, just black. But then at the end of that would always say, oh, you need to come work with us. It's a great paying job. And of course, my response was always, never in a million years. But after that poignant question, I decided that I was going to work there. And the biggest reason I decided that was that they have a unique feature where after 12 years, you're vested in your retirement plan, but it's not based upon years of service. You can retire anytime after 12 years, and your retirement's based upon hours worked. And so I worked basically 16-hour days, most of the time 6 to 7 days a week. And I would come home, because we lived about an hour and a half away from the job. So I stayed with her sister, who lived next to the mill, during the week. And so we did that for 12 years. I tell everyone we got a 30-year retirement in 12 years. So we were trying to build real estate all the time during that.
Got it.
And
okay.
So you can imagine it didn't leave a lot of time for building real estate. We always had a few small single families. Every time we would move somewhere, you know, we would buy a house and we would try to gather a little bit of real estate. And we had a few holdings, but it was very difficult to manage them, very difficult to find them, you know, working the kind of hours that we did. And when we decided that we couldn't scale, we basically started working fewer hours. So our schedule changed. We'd work Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, 16-hour days. And then on Thursday, we would work a 12-hour day. And Linda would pick us up and drive us to the airport. And we'd fly to Texas so that we could try to go look at apartment buildings and meet with brokers and do all that stuff. And then I'd fly back Sunday night and she'd pick me up and take me back to the mill. And we did that for a few years, trying to build out our portfolio with apartments.
So impressed. Not a lot of people are that driven to have a vision.
Oh, I'm not that driven.
Well, I was going to say, to be able to say, all right, this is how we're going to do it for 2 years, like working 16-hour days during the middle of the week, and then saying, all right, we're going to reach into the gas tank a little bit deeper and we're going to try to go and we're going to go do apartment buildings. What did the vision for that side hustle of apartment buildings alongside all of your guys' entrepreneurial, your work inside the steel business, where did that come about? Did it happen from the houses that you guys built, or was there some other influence there? Could you guys go into that a little bit?
Yeah, we actually moved to Florida in our early 20s, and we moved down there. Linda had the opportunity to get a transfer with her job, either to San Diego or South Florida. And we picked South Florida only because it was closer and we thought it would be easier for family to come visit us. When we went down there, I was at that point in transition and had to figure out what I was going to do. And so that's when I first got interested in real estate. And I'll be 63 this week. And I tell everyone I want to be a real estate investor when I grow up. And I've been telling them that for 40 years. So I actually got very interested way back then. And, you know, I said that we had been an entrepreneur for most of our life. And we really spent most of that time in businesses that were related to the automobile industry. So we've owned a few different businesses. We had a training company at one time. We had a small retail establishment at one time. But most of it was owning new car franchises. But when one of those endeavors came to an end, I almost always came running back to real estate.
Very great. So why did you guys always find yourself going back into the real estate space?
Well, I come, like I said, from a poor background. I had no examples of what it meant to be a business person or an entrepreneur, the one that had ever gone to college, just really did not understand that mindset at all. But luckily for me, I had some good mentors in my life very early on that introduced me to some books that changed my way of thinking. And almost everything I've ever read, almost everything I've ever heard, almost everything someone has told me at a conference always seems to come back to real estate. And so I think I just inherently thought, okay, there must be something there. I need to be involved with that.
I love that. Now, I want to dive a little bit deeper into this decision to do real estate, right? Or the slant to always want to go back in there. What type of conversations were being held at home throughout all of this churn, right? You have all these different types of businesses going on. What made you both decide that this is something that we want to really stick with long-term through all of the ups and downs of all these other businesses? What conversations were happening behind the scenes?
I'm a very lucky guy. We've been married for almost 40 years. This year will be our 40th anniversary. And
congratulations to the both of you.
Thank you very much. And I've never had to convince my wife of what I wanted to do. I've just told her, this is what I think I need to do. This is the direction I think I need to take. And she's always been extremely supportive of that. You know, I've never had to really, well, not too often anyway, had to defend that position or explain why I thought it was a good idea or any of that. She's always been there pushing me on. And it's a good thing because, you know, Derek, I've told you before that I feel like my life has all been uphill and that it's every two steps forward is one step back. And I think part of that has been somebody behind me always pushing me up that hill. So she's always been very, very supportive in that regard. Even after all of the failures, and I've had a ton of them, and jokingly say that I'm a genius, and she always wants to know how I figure I'm a genius. Well, they say you learn something from every failure, right? So I've had enough failures that obviously I'm a genius.
That's so great, you guys. Now, this unwavering faith in your spouse, that's something that Sophie and I are really, really trying to help bring the importance to our audience, because not only is it in any type of entrepreneurial endeavor, not only is it the fact that you need to have drive yourself, but you also need to have the space, time space, the physical space, the supportive space from someone that's living with you to enable all of this to happen. What you guys have done has just been amazing. You know, you guys have studied the course and stayed true to what is important to you guys. And there's a lot of faith in both of your guys' skills in each other, right? Just because you know each other well. For those out there that may not be at that point yet, where they're at a point where, you know, maybe one spouse is moving in one direction and the other is kind of either hesitant or has questions or doesn't have true faith in what direction that's heading down. What advice would you, maybe for Linda or for you, Jim, what advice would you have for those spouses or for those couples?
For me, Derek, it's a lot of be open and honest and communicate with me. Tell me what's going on. Don't let me sit there and think about, are we losing a lot of money and nothing's coming out of it? I support Jim 100%, but I get nervous. I get really nervous, especially when he says, I need to run to the bank. I need to make a deposit. And I'm like, okay, don't tell me how much you're taking out. Don't tell me. I don't want to know. But later on down the road, show me the money. I want to know what we made. But other than that, Derek, it's just being open and honest and me trusting that he's making all the right decisions.
That's fantastic. And I'm sorry to ask more questions. I know Sophie's itching to ask something, but I was going to ask you. So this is on the financial front. What would you say the other parts of your relationship has enabled on that financial side? Like, would you say that they're, you know, maybe your guys is the way that you communicate with one another on things that aren't business related? Do you think that that feeds into the strength of what you do on the business side as well? Or maybe you can talk to that a little bit more.
When my kids got married and when other young people that are close to me have gotten married, and I've ever been asked what we feel the secret is to our marriage lasting as long as it has, I have an answer that I oftentimes get confused about, and that's because I'm 63. But I say there's either three or four C's. You know, you've got to communicate, you've got to compromise, you've got to have courage. And there's a commitment that we have to to each other. And it wavers, it goes up, it goes down, it goes sideways. And like any marriage, we've had times where Linda, had it not been for her, that our finances would have fallen apart. There's times where it's been on me. We've always been very supportive of each other. So I try to push her to achieve the goals that she had or wanted to have. And she does the same for me. And I think we do a very good job of trying to, when one of us is not taking the lead, to support the other. And when we see the other one starting to get tired a little bit, then we step forward and try to help out. So we don't work well together, but we work well at pushing each other.
That's excellent. Yeah, thank you so much. It's so inspiring to hear, especially a couple who've been together so long. And like you said, have gone through the ups and downs, been together for 40 years. I'm curious, Linda, can you talk about some really tough moments and how you got through it and what mindset you both had to have in order to create that resilience that could be so inspiring for our listeners out there?
Having a full-time job and him being away during the week years ago when we were both going through our careers, and I can't really say he had a career, I had a career. I was a logistics manager for a big corporation, and I worked that job for 20 years. I loved it. I retired in 2012, and I thought, I gotta do something different. I can't continue doing what I'm doing, and once Jim left the mill, it was like, okay, what are we gonna do now? Let's really focus on you working on real estate, but you're going to have to leave the job. And honestly, Sophie, I used to worry about him day in and day out when he was at work because of how dangerous his job was. And he always tells me, you don't know the half of what I went through at that mill. And now that he's out of it, it's just like having him home. And having him home is not really like having him home, because he is on Zoom calls, at Zoom meetings, on his computers all day long. And it's just like, honey, are you going to have dinner with me? He goes, is it on the calendar? And so now that we're both retired and he is doing his thing, I have my own little business. I have a eBay business and I keep busy with that. So I think both of us doing our thing while we're both home really keeps us pretty sane. But I love what he's doing. But now it's getting to the point where it's just like, okay, show me the money, honey. You know, are we making any money? But it's fun. We love it.
That's really great. Yeah, thank you guys. I think it's cool to have a sneak peek into what Sophie and I's future are going to be, because that's what it feels like. You know, when we grow up, we want to be just like you guys. And then when you guys grow up, you want to be real estate investors, right? So I think that we all know where that leads, right? So to real estate investing. But let's back up a little bit more and talk about, again, I think this is just really important for people to listen to. All of the variables and all the things that you're juggling at home. You have kids, you have a dangerous job, or at least from what Linda perceives as a dangerous job. And Jim, you probably weren't against admitting that it was pretty dangerous. You have all these balls up in the air at the same time, and you're still going to do real estate. That drive for being your own independent person, was there anything from maybe you guys growing up or any specific event that kind of triggered all of this happening? Or has this just been the path that you've been following your whole life?
Well, I grew up so poor that you felt you weren't really smart enough to have a good job, but you could work hard enough to have three. And so I've been a workaholic all my life, even in high school, playing high school sports. I had a job in the morning before school, and then I had a job in the evening after football practice or basketball practice. And when we got married, in every business, as you guys know, when you have a business, a small business, you're literally on call 24/7, 365 days a year. And Linda also has had a very strong work ethic her entire life. And she will joke about how much time I spend at my desk, but our offices are literally on the opposite side of the wall from each other. And every time I get up and walk into her office, she's always at her store listing and taking pictures or checking inventory. So, you know, we like to stay busy, and neither one of us particularly like doing yard work or housework. So it's a lot more, if you stay busy in your job, kind of in your vocation, then you can make the excuse that the yard can wait another 3 or 4 days before we mow the grass.
That's great. Yeah. And also to Linda's point too, when she said, okay, now real estate and that work ethic of like wanting to always be busy, eventually that gets to a point where you're working too much. And actually, you know, just a little point of vulnerability here, because this is mentioned in the book that I wrote as well about investing in real estate part-time with a full-time job. But, you know, there was a point in time where Sophie had thought that I was in love more with real estate than I was with her. And so
that's me, Sophie. Yep.
So there you go. And so it was a very treacherous time. There was a lot of things going on in the portfolio. I was just starting to ramp up, and it was really becoming this all-encompassing thing where you start to understand all the benefits and you start to get excited, and it just kind of gets away from you. I love how you guys can keep, it seems like you keep each other in check, right? You both have your businesses, so you can understand where each other come from. But at the same time, you both have work ethic and you guys know when to cut it off. I think that's a really important thing to talk about for balance. And that's another reason that I want to talk about your background, your work ethic, and some of those things that those people out there, they have to understand that while work ethic is important and it's important to stay driven on the path, you still have to be balanced in what you're doing.
Yeah, and I'd like to address that and say that not everyone has the same desire to work as many hours or as hard. And trust me, I'm from Tennessee originally. And if there's one thing about my Tennessee heritage that I embrace, it's the lazy hillbilly boy in barefoot and asleep on the front porch. I embrace that. I like that. It hasn't been my life. But when you're not the sharpest tool in the shed, you got to make up for it somehow. And I've made up for it by being hard at work. But had it not been for the support that I have from Linda, it would have ruined most marriages. And we do cherish our time together. And I think that for us, sometimes you hear about when you have two parents at both work, it's not how much time you spend with your kids, it's the quality of the time that you do spend. And our favorite time of the day is in our favorite place. We have our comfy little couch, which is a little love seat that we sit on and fall asleep together at the end of the day. And
it's called our snuggle time.
Our snuggle
time. I love that.
And sometimes it's not long. Sometimes I'm so exhausted, I just fall asleep. But we always spend a little bit of time with each other at the end of the day, always.
Yeah, that's wonderful. And I would disagree about your comment about not being the smartest, sharpest tool in the shed, because with everything that I've heard about you, know about you, I definitely, what you've done despite your upbringing, growing up in poverty, and just all of the experiences, the tough experiences that you both share together, I want to say, like, again, it's so inspiring to our listeners. And like Derek was saying earlier, it was going through all of that and, you know, touching upon your comment of if you didn't have the support of Linda, it would have been very, very hard, right, to have the success you have now and to endure long withstanding 40-year marriage. And one of the things that we came across that I'd like to hear from you guys is that we started talking about our shared vision, because at one point in time, I didn't necessarily see the same vision as Derek, because I thought, well, because for one, he never shared it. And two, I'm like, well, if I don't know what it is, how can I know if mine's aligned? So I want to hear from both of you in terms of what was your shared vision throughout the whole 40 years that kept the momentum going for all of this hard work?
For me, I would say that shared vision is those three or four C's of what makes a strong marriage. Our shared vision is that courage, commitment, compromise, and communication to each other. That has been the common thread that has held us together. It's not our shared vision for a particular job or a particular industry. Linda has supported me 100% in real estate, but she also supported me 100% when I was in the automotive business. She's not always agreed with every decision I've made and has always challenged me to think about what I'm doing. She's not always agreed with every partner that I have picked. And I had to defend those positions. And in hindsight, I defended them a little too well, because she was right in every circumstance. But she doesn't hold that against me and say, no, you've already done that. We're not going down that path again. She gives me every opportunity to fail and supports me even when that does happen. And that's why I've been able to start over again and again and again. And each time that I've had to start over, we've always wound up just a little bit further ahead, just a little bit further up that hill. But for you, honey, I don't know.
Compromise. He gives in a lot.
I think it's because he's just really happy.
Just so you guys know, you know, I've been throwing that in there for at least 30 of those 40 years. But what I don't say is I'm the one doing all the compromise.
So true.
And the fourth C of courage wasn't always there. Fourth C of courage came into play because you've got to have the courage, even when you think you're right. Someone has to have the courage to step forward and be wrong or to give in. Even if you're not wrong, you have to have the courage to give in, because if you don't, it doesn't lead to a good place. It's hard to recover from that.
That's right. I think that the people that win most in their marriage and also in life in general are the ones that take responsibility for things. And sometimes they're even willing to take responsibility for things outside of their direct control, but, you know, things that you could have prevented. And so I think that locus, that internal locus of control that you're taking and making your own responsibility is something that you guys have in spades. And this is just a natural outflow. All the success that you guys are having right now in both the balance of your life, in the business success that you're having, is just kind of an external expression of that type of attitude. Thanks for being a great role model for all of our listeners. Let's go ahead and switch gears. I wanted to talk about real estate investing a little bit more, since this is a real estate investing show and probably lots of people out there, a lot of our listeners and perhaps your listeners, are wondering how real estate fit into this overall picture and how it started up. And I think we got an overview that it was like you were moving from house to house, but now you're doing multifamily. So can you guys talk us through like that whole journey that you went through from moving from house to house as you moved in and moved out and you kept the house, moved to the next one? What went from there to intentionally investing in rental real estate and then starting to get into more of the syndication world? Maybe you can walk us through that journey. And I would love to hear it from both of your guys' perspectives as well, if possible.
Well, sure. For me, I think that we have a very common vision that almost everyone in real estate has this vision that I'm going to buy 10 houses and each one's going to cash flow X number of dollars. And I'm going to do that every year for 10 years. And then I'm going to retire. Of course, you figure out very quickly for most people, not for everyone, that that's a very hard thing to do while you're working another job. And for me in particular, it was extremely hard. And Linda wasn't interested in going out and doing that. She had a full-time career of her own. And we had three kids at home. And so got to a point where I had to figure out a different way to scale. And I attended a CCIM conference on a Sunday night and met Gene Trowbridge years ago and listened to him speak, then spent the rest of that weekend talking to him about syndication, what it was, and because I had never heard of it. I had no idea what it was and had no clue that you could just make a bunch of friends and kind of come together and pool your money and buy an apartment building. You know, I'd had nothing but bad things happen to me when I started creating partnerships. So it wasn't in my mindset to do that on something this big. But as it turned out, I learned a lot about what not to do in partnerships. And there's a lot of structure in buying apartment buildings, a lot of legal that you're kind of forced into doing. And I did not grow up like that. I knew nothing about having contracts and having a lawyer on your team or a CPA on your team. Or, you know, for me, it was a handshake and I trust you till you prove me wrong. And that is no way to run a business. It's amazing that we wound up where we did. That was kind of the aha moment that, look, we don't have a lot of time here. So what time we do have, we need to spend it trying to buy these bigger assets. If we're going to spend X number of hours a month doing that. And that was where we started to scale back for several years so that we could spend those longer weekends trying to build out the business. And it got to a point where when I retired, I wanted to retire so that I could concentrate on real estate. But I really never got to the point where real estate was really going to supplement my income. I never replaced my income. My family or her family was right. It was a dangerous, dirty place, but it did pay very, very well. And when you're working as much as I did, it was a big salary to overcome. But Linda had worked for years and we are very good at saving and very thrifty. We were in a good spot so that we could start to try to do this full time. And I had had a lot of health issues anyway. And so she wanted me out of the mill and wanted me to do something. And it's kind of, it gave me the opportunity, because believe me, when I took that W-2 job, that itch that you get when you're an entrepreneur never went away. And so we just got to a point where, okay, we have a little retirement here. We're not going to be homeless. We'll be okay no matter what. And it gave me the opportunity to come back and pursue some of my passions.
Fantastic. And thank you, Jim. That's great. Linda, what was it like from your side going through this journey of moving from house to house and then going into real estate? Was it mostly on Jim's side, or what was the support like for you that you had to provide him if you weren't as involved?
It was mostly on Jim's side. As a matter of fact, my parents called us gypsies because we were constantly moving, but we were always improving from the houses that we were moving to. We were, it was another step up. And when Jim decided that he wanted to join that group of
another guru, for the over and over and over again,
and we had to pay into it, I said, okay, but this is the last one. And so we jumped into it together. And when I realized there were 400 or 500 other members, I thought, this is very competitive. And after a couple of years, I said, honey, you've got to get out and do this on your own. You've got to do something different because you're just in the same pool with everybody else. And yes, you have a coach, but it just doesn't seem like the coach is there to really help you. So you need to start really working hard and doing this, and I will be there for you. What were you going to say?
You can see it's not my drive. That's the push. That's that hand I always feel in my back.
Well, but you know what, Derek and Sophie, I was scared the whole time. It's scary for me, and it's still scary for me, but because we are in our 60s. And so I'm like, okay, as long as we're going to live the rest of our lives comfortably, I'm okay. But if you feel that this is going to get us somewhere, because like you said, we want to leave a legacy for our children, our three sons and our grandchildren. So I'm going to be there for you, but we got to start seeing something, babe, because we're getting up there in age. So
I support you, but show me the money.
Right.
That's great. I love that. Again, that's more accountability, right? And I think that, you know, Linda, you're pushing Jim to say, look, if you're really interested in this thing, then do it, right? That's really, really admirable. It just means that your guys' bond is so strong that you trust each other so much to be like, okay, yeah, we're going to spend the money on this guruship, but when we do, I'm expecting results.
Exactly. Exactly.
Fantastic. Really great. I'll pause for a second and see if Sophie wants to ask a question because I've been kind of like jumping in constantly.
No, it's great. Yeah. And again, thank you both for just being so open, so vulnerable, because this is what our listeners need to hear. Because oftentimes when we're talking about real estate, entrepreneurship, business, we only see like the front facing, right? The transactions. And the beauty of it is what's lying behind the scenes, the journey that has taken place over all of these years, the resilience, the tenacity, the support, the bonds, the conversations. And again, what you guys have provided so far has been just gold for us, especially. We're being selfish because we get an hour with you guys with no interruptions. But can you both talk to, in terms of, again, maybe for couples who are just starting off, especially Linda, I'd like to pose this question to you too, because I know you've been such a big support, but you've also shown yourself to be such a pillar of strength as a female. And oftentimes, and I ask this to all of our female guests too, what do you think are the crucial components to developing that strength in a relationship? I'm not posing it.
To me, it's a lot of trust. I mean, to me, that is the biggest factor with him. I trust in what you're doing. I believe in what you're doing. If you feel, and it's what he enjoys doing. So I need to be there to support him because it makes him feel good. He wants to do this. And a lot of the things that he's doing, I go, so you're giving all of that knowledge for free? And he's like, you know what? It'll come back, honey, 100 times back to me. So trust me, it's going to work. And I go, okay, because I'm sure like the big gurus that are out there charging for all of this that he's giving away for free, he's telling me he'll get it back. He'll get it back. So it's a lot of trust. I believe in everything he's doing.
I would add to that, that in a marriage, if you aren't lucky enough to have someone who gives you that much rope, that it's going to be very, very hard. to do this. And that if you don't have that, you need to pause long enough. Your marriage is more important than anything, any job, any endeavor. Sometimes you just can't see those things until you just get older, that the things that are the most important in your life. And as much as we put ourselves out there to build a career, you need to pause long enough. If you are a person that needs a lot more time in your marriage, you need to take that time. And you need to build an understanding, a bond, a relationship where you can support each other. And if you can't get to that place, then you need to find something else to do. And I really believe that. It doesn't have to be X, Y, or Z. It can be A, B, C. But cherish your marriage and have the commitment that no matter what happens, that comes first for you, that that is the most important piece. Now, a lot of people think that my marriage is not the first thing for me, that my wife is not the first thing for me because of how hard I work sometimes. But I can absolutely guarantee you that it is, that if she didn't give me that liberty, that I wouldn't do it. And even when she might not have understood what I was doing or might not have even believed as much as I did in what I was doing, but she always supported me in doing it and gave me that opportunity to either succeed or fail.
But you
and
know
didn't
what?
Judge me.
I have to say, it's not perfect. It's no. Because there are times when I ask a lot of questions and he's like, honey, I already told you that. I go, well, tell me again, because I probably didn't get it the first time. He's like, okay, but you're going to listen this time, right? And I go, yes, I'll listen. Because when he has said things to me, he's like, I just explained that to you yesterday or a week ago. And I'm like, I don't recall that. So please explain it to me again. So trust me, it's not perfect. There are times where we have sat down and have had long conversations. And I do have to be told a second, sometimes a third time about what are you doing with this or whatever it is he's on a Zoom call. Because I do listen a lot when I'm in the other room, I'm listening to him. And as soon as he gets off that call, I'm like, I have a question for you, you know, and he's like, okay. And we sit down and discuss it because I'm in there with my little pad too. I don't have sound on my computer when I'm working because it's just listing or doing inventory. But I am listening to him through the wall, so.
See, I told you, I knew she was listening.
There you go.
She pokes her head out that door and says, what did you say? What are you doing?
I think that that's great. I think the other thing too is like the transparency that you guys have with one another and the fact that there's nothing to hide. And something that I also want to underscore that, Jim, you touched on too, is that if your marriage is in a place where it cannot sustain another dynamic going in there. Sometimes having kids itself, that's already a strain on a marriage, right? Because now all of a sudden you have this extra entity, this outside, you know, this little baby that now demands all the attention. So then you have to be even stronger in your marriage. And now you're adding this extra dynamic of real estate investing or starting a business or going on business on your own. And those dynamics really need to be nurtured because here's the reason why. It all starts with that vision that we were talking about before, but also when you get to the place that you want to get to, which is a lot of these younger people out there that are doing this are looking for financial independence, right? They start in the syndication world, they start in real estate investing because they want to be financially free. Well, what happens when you are financially free? Then what? Now, are you going to be financially free by yourself because you don't have a marriage anymore? Because you put all of your time capital into building a business and now you don't have a marriage anymore? What's the whole point, right? Like the whole point is to build a better life. And so while you're going through the process, you have to maintain that better life. And that's something that I've, you know, had to learn the hard way with those tough conversations with my wife. But that's something that only happens, bringing this back around full circle with Linda, which you said is when you guys are constantly communicating and being curious about what's happening in the other person's life and still maintaining that relationship using real estate investing or using businesses as like a platform to elevate your relationship with one another. Because now you have something to share, you're learning something together, you're bouncing ideas off of each other. It's just a whole other way to connect.
You know what, Derek, that point, even when your spouse doesn't necessarily have as keen an interest in what you're doing as you do, and doesn't necessarily understand it to the same level or depth that you do, they still need to have like you said, a curiosity about what you're doing, because you are so amped up sometimes and you just need to be able to share what you're doing, and you need to feel like it's not just, oh yeah, They have a genuine interest. Even, you know, even if it's fake, I don't care. You know, I just want to feel like my wife, it's kind of like you want the respect of your father, and I want the respect of my wife. And I don't want to let down her. I don't want to let down my family. So those are all pressures that drive me. You do need to take enough time to try to share what you're doing with your spouse, so that even if it's just tacit approval, it's still approval.
Yeah, very well said there. Yeah, great thing. I can't add anything on top of that, because everything that we've been talking about is 100% true, and this is real life. So for all those listeners out there, this is really what happens. Okay, let's jump back into real estate real quick before we start wrapping things up here. In real estate now, I know you guys are on a walk right now, and you have this special project that you've been working on that Linda, you were alluding to a little bit. Can you maybe talk a little bit about what's going on in your world right now in terms of real estate and what it is that you guys are trying to do at this point in your lives?
Yeah. So in a nutshell, I've shared with you that I spent 40 years kind of with an interest in real estate and always going back to it and participating in a lot of different training programs and mentoring programs, because you know, you always feel like you need a boost. When you just spent 5 years trying to build another business, now you feel like you're behind and you've got to catch up. And so you go out and you look for that shortcut, that efficiency, and hope that that coach can help you catch up. And I've done that over and over and over again. And I think there's a lot of false narratives in those programs and the way they're pitched to people. And we don't have another hour to go into depth. I'll give you the 30 second elevator pitch of that, which is, I believe that if you have 30 grand, 50 grand, 100 grand to give to someone to train you, that the very best place to put that money, if you're an apartment investor, is into an apartment. That apartment will be the greatest teacher you've ever had. If you're doing a really good job, it'll be a very easy teacher to work with. And if you're doing a very poor job, it'll be the worst taskmaster that you've ever had. But it will not give up on you. It will not let you slack off. It'll grind you into the ground if you don't take time to try to do what it wants you to do. To ask a human being to do that is unrealistic and unreasonable. For them to have the same level of concern about your success is an extremely rare trait for any human being. So everyone wants to believe in the abundance mentality, and that's the platform that we've created, the GOB Network. We're really testing that theory. We're trying to give away 40 years worth of experience from our entrepreneurial pursuits, but also 40 years of experience of going back to the well over and over again to these training programs, and provide everything that they provide, but use a model, a proven business model, but not in our space, not in this real estate space. And when I say the proven business model, it comes from the tech industry primarily. And it's a freemium model. We don't charge for what we are giving away, whether that be training or tools or resources or connections or network, or also it's a place you can go find net worth and liquidity and capital when you need it. And we're trying to help make those connections. And it is a passion project for me, and something that I feel I finally found that thing that is going to be my legacy. And I think it's going to outlive me long after I'm gone, and because it doesn't depend on me. It's built on that crowd source or crowd hive mind mentality. And it relies on everyone that's in the program, not an individual, to guide the program. And I tell people that, you know, I'm just the guy that laid the foundation and had the idea to do it and had nothing to lose. I had already lost early in 2020, so big that it's very difficult to talk about. But I knew the only thing I could not do is jeopardize what net worth and liquidity we had left. I had to protect that. And this was a way for me to overcome all of the things that I didn't like about the industry and also bring so much more. Our vision has, with every person that has joined us on this journey, our vision has grown with each person because each person is bringing something else to the platform. I might be able to solve one or two problems for a student or a mentee if I were a mentor, but if there's 1,000 different possible obstacles in your way, I can't solve 1,000 obstacles. I can't overcome 1,000. So I need at least 1,000 solutions. And so I need 1,000 people with one solution, not one guy with 10 or 100 solutions. In essence, is what the platform is about.
Yeah, and I will say too that platform is by invitation only, but as a member myself, I've been seeing a lot of the selflessness and caring and all the questions and all the informity and the willingness to help that's on the platform. So I will say that, you know, Jim, you've done a fantastic job of curating and making sure that the right people are in the network so that we maximize each other's efforts. Because, man, there are people in there that are like, hey, I know how to code. You know, I can write some script for you, or, you know, here's the password for, you know, for some Excel thing or something like that, right? And there's tons of value there. And so just the value that you've already created, I would say that you've been successful in your abundance mentality because of all the people in the network. It's up to hundreds now, right? I think we're in the hundreds.
We're growing exponentially. I think we're over 200 now.
Yeah, that's right. So with everyone that gets added, that just means that there's more and more value for the existing members and for the new members coming on. So I think it was a fantastic idea, an insight, a stroke of great brilliance, I would say. And congratulations to you and the success that you're having there. And hopefully you're having fun with it too, because it sounds like you are.
I am having a blast. You know, I tell everyone that I feel like the ball is rolling quick enough. I said that my life has been all uphill. I've never had a flat spot to catch my breath, but the ball is rolling downhill. And so I'm starting to chase that. And so maybe I have finally reached the nexus and starting on the way down, but I'm very excited about it. I think it already does not need me, but I am having so much fun. I have no intention of stepping away. I'm just having the best time of my life.
Linda, don't worry. We have a recording of this. So if you need to play that back or something,
thank you, Derek.
So, all right, cool. Well, thank you so much for sharing what you guys are up to. Obviously, in the introduction, we let everyone know what it is that you guys are doing right now, all the deals that you guys are working on. And so we're very excited to further the conversation there for you. But before we go into just an open book for anything you guys have going on that you want your listeners to, as a call to action, we're going to go ahead and do what's called our rapid round. It's 5 questions that we ask every single one of our guests. And so we'd like to bring you guys on as well to do this. And most of the questions are for each of you individually.
First question is, what book has had the biggest impact on you and why? And it doesn't have to be business, real estate related, anything, fair game.
For me, I think there's so many of them, but if I had to give away one book, and that's kind of how I gauge it, because I can't pick one, but I know the one that I like to give away the most. And for me, it was The Magic of Thinking Big by Schwartz. Is a very small book, but it had a huge impact on my thinking at a very, very early age in my life. So Linda, I think, was thinking that we wouldn't have done well on the newlywed game on this one, I don't think.
No, but we were just talking about The Rich Dad, Poor Dad, which was my book, only because he forced me to read it. And he forced our kids to read it. So definitely.
Well, I'm still not sure they ever read it, but but I've given them each at least 3 copies. So
I will say that Rich Dad, Poor Dad is a very common book that comes up. And so I think that it's absolutely one of those books for people to just start out that absolutely need to have that perspective change. And I think his The Cash Flow Quadrant is also really good as well to go deeper in. He has a few other ones as well that go past that, but those are the fundamentals. Like, those are the really good ones. So thanks for sharing that.
So next question is, if people wanted to be just like you guys, what would be the first actionable thing that they could do?
They need to memorize the 4 C's and start practicing them.
I agree.
That's amazing. Cool. I've never heard that before.
Yeah.
But you know what? More than anything, besides trust, that communication goes a long way too. I mean, always communicate with your spouse. Let them know what's going on, because if you shut them out, then they feel like, help me out here.
Yeah, when you feel like you're in the dark or you're not part of the process and part of the decision,
right,
it diminishes your role in the marriage. And that's not fair. You're not doing yourself any favors because you're married to that person. They can make your life miserable. So you need a partner. You don't need a confrontation. You don't need an opponent.
That's right.
I don't think that's why you got married. And so you need to remember that and nurture that.
That's beautiful. Thank you.
So what about you, Jim?
First off, you need to find yourself a really, really, really good woman.
Yes.
And then
or a guy.
Make sure that you have the courage to compromise.
Love
and
it.
To communicate.
I think my husband's calling me next door.
Don't answer that call. So, you know, I think that subconsciously, I have been preaching those four C's our entire marriage. Mm. That I think that we both have 100% bought into that concept. And Linda's willingness to not give up on our marriage, her willingness not to leave, not to walk away. Because when marriages come to an end, it's because one of you gave up, and she has never given up. And I've given her plenty of opportunities to give up.
Oh, man. You know, I'm not saying, Jim, I think that you are a very pleasant person. And I think, so I'm not saying any of this, but there's a lot of pressure when you have the steel work, you have the real estate going on, you've got kids, and you're making these trips and you're traveling. There's so much room for stress in there. Oh. And think that if, Linda, if you're willing to say yes to what Jim said, then that we'll call that the answer.
Yes.
Okay, there you go.
100%.
Wonderful. Okay, guys. And the next question is, what small thing do most people not know about you?
Well, I will say that I tell people that if I were to describe my life, and I mean that collectively, in a book, it would be The Millionaire Next Door. So most people do not know what we do. Most people are not aware what goes on behind our closed doors. You know, we still drive. She's been bugging me to get her a new car for at least 7 years.
And
I still drive a 2000 Cadillac Escalade with a busted windshield and a big dent in the back door.
Oh,
and
my goodness.
She drives a 2009 Honda Civic, and that's our new car. And the wheel wells are rusting on that. And she's really jealous because last night, my youngest son dropped off his new car and parked it in the driveway. And so she's been looking out the door, you know, every little bit, you know, and making sure that I know she's looking out the door.
That's really great. Love it. Fantastic.
Awesome, guys. And Linda?
I'm a big thrift shopper. I love going to the thrift stores. I love going to Goodwill. I mean, that's me. But if my friends knew about it, I'd go, me? Shop there? I don't think you'd ever catch. Even my sister tells me, she goes, just hope you never croak in a thrift store. That'd be embarrassing for you.
That's
you
really
funny. You know what's ironic about that is my wife's eBay store is Linda's Unique Boutique, and she really concentrates on selling real high-end items, and for a long time only sold like designer items. And you know, it really is a contrast to who she really is. So if she keeps one of those purses for herself, it'll be one that's probably as old as my car
that I bought at the thrift store.
Hey, you know, I do have to say that, like, sometimes you can find some really good deals there. Like, I mean, there's nothing wrong with that. It's just, you know, it may take a while. And sometimes, like, if you're just lucky, then someone is just giving away something, right? And then it's
unbelievable the things that people give away. And especially when I buy it for $1 or $2 and I sell it for a couple $100. The excitement that I get. And amazing. I share that with Jim. I go, guess what I just sold? I sold a Louis Vuitton dust bag for a couple $100 that I picked up for a couple bucks. And then he gets excited for me too. But it's such a great feeling to know that you're picking up these things for nothing, because I did sell a lot of high-end stuff that I was paying good money for. But I would try to double my money on that. And then when I started hitting the thrift stores, I'm like, wow, this is the way to go. I'm spending a few dollars and making good money on it.
How much time would you how much time
that's
would you
my
say?
Excitement.
That's awesome. Nice. I was going to say, how much time do you think we were spending at Ross?
Yeah, we were going to Ross. We were going to Goodwill. Oh, the most interesting thing that I ever found at Goodwill was there was Harvard diploma that belonged to someone who got their MBA from Harvard. And it was just sitting there.
Yeah.
And
I remember that.
I think it was going for about 50 cents. I'm like, this diploma must have cost this person like $250,000 to get in his year. It's sitting here. And so, yeah, like, just find the most interesting
so
things.
Weird.
Yes, you do.
Yeah, but we would stock up on books. I mean, our whole library is just bags and bags of books. So I'm with you, Linda, 100%.
And really important books like The Magic of Thinking Big, The Richest Man in Babylon, like some of those really classic, really important ones.
Yeah, and next question is, how do you each like to unwind and restore your creative juices?
Oh my God.
Our snuggle time.
Yeah, and with a glass of wine.
Nice.
Yeah, I have to have my glass of wine each night and, you know, in my snuggle time on the couch with my wife.
But like he said, it'll last as soon as that glass is empty. And I always tell him, please do not put your hand on the glass when after you, especially if it's half full, because he'll be, dozing. And I'm like, oh, it's on the carpet. Now I just have a little towel by, the side of the couch because it'll be on the floor.
Jim, would it detract from the experience if you had like a wine hat, like have the beer hats and like you've got like the straw going?
It's funny, Derek. I was joking on Brian Briscoe's call the other day that they were all talking about their chairs and this and that, and I said, you guys don't have a Zoom chair, and they're like, a Zoom chair? What's a Zoom chair? I said, yeah. I said, I spend so much time in front of Zoom now that I invented a chair and I'm patenting it, and it's a porta potty chair, and it's got a hydration pack on the back, and it's got a little table that you flip over so that you can eat while you're on your Zoom call. Plugins for USB.
Linda, you're probably cringing on the inside.
Oh yes.
It's got one of those the Japanese that clean your butt
like
for
the
you.
Bidets.
Oh, the bidet. Yeah, one of those too.
Well, that's in there. I've got the blow dryer and everything. It's on the chair. Here, if you listen real close, I'll turn it on.
Oh, that's so great. Oh man. Okay. Last question. Right? Okay. Yeah. So the last question is there something special that you and your family, like with your kids, do you like to do together?
Yeah, we've had a tradition that started with her mom, those Friday night dinners and what we call a Sunday brunch. So we don't have a set Friday night dinner, but we love having barbecues with family. And my brother-in-law just absolutely loves to barbecue. He thinks he's the greatest chef, in the world. And so we do spend that kind of quality family time together. And for years, we had a standing Sunday brunch that we make a traditional Mexican brunch, and it's not every Sunday anymore
because
everyone has grown up and moved away, but they still love it when we do get together and kind of call the family together for Sunday brunch.
That's great. Thank you guys. Fantastic. I think that's a great thing to do for a family and good tradition to have. I think that that's something we're going to emulate in the future for sure. When we grow up to be just like you guys. All right, cool. Well, so we've reached towards the end of the show. So at this point, I'm going to give you an open platform right now to say whatever it is that you'd like to say to both your audience and ours, but for both of you. So Linda, if you want to talk about your business, and then Jim, if there's any message that you want to relay to our audiences.
Well, after I retired in 2012, I started my eBay business in 2004, but it was all part-time. So I went full-time after I retired in 2012. And if anybody wants to visit my eBay business, it's Linda's Unique Boutique or Jeroma General Store. And right now I've got about 350 items listed, anywhere from designer items to kids' clothes and household items, so they can go there and take a look at my my store.
So there's another little tidbit that nobody knows, is the reason Linda has this business is because she loves to shop. And we reached a point in our life where that was a bone of contention, and we had to figure out a way to solve that. And so our compromise was she could buy as much as she wanted to, as long as she sold it to somebody else, because that, and that gave her that vehicle. And it's like a stress relief for her almost, going out and finding deals and hunting deals. And so she continues the business so that she can continue having fun.
And, you know, you guys, that's amazing. I think I'm definitely going to leave all of this in here, because that's some really, really good stuff. Like, that's fantastic. That's the compromise thing. And then you're also able to come to solutions and talk with each other and have a curiosity rather than, I mean, because Jim, you could have easily said, that's enough, stop, you know, yeah, no more. And then that's the end of it.
Trust me, Derek, I tried that several times. It didn't work.
You know what, Derek, it also keeps me out of his hair. Because in the morning, when he gets on the Zoom call, I go, okay, I'll be back. And he goes, take your time, hon. You know, I got a lot of calls today. So I'm gone most of the day on my thrift adventures. So
it wasn't that much of a compromise. I figured out later on, I was just trying to break even. But as it turns out, not only does she love to find bargains, but she loves when the bargain is on her side when she sells. She just really gets a thrill out of marketing her stuff and that thrill of the hunt, so to speak.
Yeah, I love that.
But for me, the only thing I want to say more about the GOB network is to the point of it is by invitation only. And the reason for that is, you know, I said it's a freemium model that we're not charging financially to be on the platform, but there is a cost to be on the platform. And that's why it's not just open. We are looking for a particular personality. We're looking for go-givers and another great book. And we're looking for people that will leave as much as they take from the platform. And we want them to take abundantly. And so far it's working out. And we're very, very happy with where that's going. So.
Yeah, and I will say again, you know, this is just to bring this up. As a member, the value that I've taken away and tried to contribute to this has been tremendous. It's fantastic. There's some very, very active folks in there, up to the point where we're scheduling weekly calls to talk about underwriting, or we're scheduling capital raising calls to talk about how to raise capital. And it's just taking a life of its own. And I just think it's very admirable what's been set up. And so I'm proud to be a part of it. And thank you very much for putting the groundwork together to get it all set up. It's been great.
We are extremely grateful that you decided to join us on that journey. And we are so grateful for so many people that are demonstrating that go-giver spirit that did not need to come on this platform. They did not need us. They were already doing very well for themselves and were already on that path to success, but still decided to join us and to add all of that value they were creating. And they're allowing us to participate in it because they are go-givers. And the beautiful thing about that is that the more people that give, and the broader that brand becomes, it's a self-feeding mechanism. It comes back to you in waves. And so we're very, very proud of that. And as long as you are that kind of person, you just need to find someone like Derek that can invite you onto the platform.
Excellent. Yeah, absolutely. And I will also say too that, you know, in the exercise of abundance, it's been checking all of those boxes on it, and very powerful. For those people who are just starting in their commercial real estate journey, you'll find that you will go much farther together than if you try to do it on your own. And this is just one of those things where in a team sport like commercial real estate investing, this type of platform enables that team to thrive together and for you to build your own team too. I've seen deals get done because of it, right? And it's just fantastic. And this is just the beginning. So very excited to see what's in store for that.
You can never have too many friends in this business. And that the essence of that platform to demonstrate that abundance, I'm going to put a challenge out to the GOB network to make this the number one podcast that Derek has ever had.
Oh, that's
and
so
I
sweet.
Want everyone to like it. I want everyone to give it a thumbs up, find it on YouTube or wherever it is on the interwebs, and give a lot of support to what you are doing also.
Fantastic. Thank you so much, Jim. That means a lot to the both of us. Thank you. And with that, I think we're going to go ahead and close out the show. For those of you who have listened all the way to the end, we really, really appreciate you guys tuning in. And if you guys want to hear more of this, please make sure that you hit like, subscribe, so that the algorithm gods, wherever you're listening to this, it can go up that chain so that more people can get exposure to this show, because we feel this is super important for people to understand that there's another side to real estate investing and entrepreneurship. It's the conversations that happened at home, and the thriving that kind of allows entrepreneurship to come out. So that's why we're so passionate about this show. Please, like I said, like, subscribe, go onto our website at Elevate Equity, where we embody all of those values and trying to help people escape their W-2 or learn about commercial real estate investing or just be helpful in any way we can at all. That's what we're all about. Thank you guys so much for listening. And this is Derek.
And this is Sophie.
Signing off. Thank you guys. Thank you. Have a great day. Thanks for being on, you guys. Bye.